Is it good to go?
You're good to go.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. It's my pleasure to introduce our seminar speaker today. Dr. Greg Penner got his first 2 degrees here at the University of Saskatchewan, and then moved on and completed his PhD at the University of Alberta in 2009. Shortly after that, he started his appointment here as a faculty member at the University of Saskatchewan. Greg currently holds the Centennial Enhancement Research Chair in Ruminant Nutritional Physiology. And I know that Greg is very active in pursuing funding, recruiting, and supervising students, and has a very active research program. And I'm looking forward to hearing what he has to say today. I'll leave it to you, Greg.
Thank you, Trevor. Thanks, everyone, for coming, both in person and online. So today, I want to share with you some work we've been doing on gut health for beef cattle. Why we've been focusing on gut health really is because the gut is a central organ system. And so we're going to go through many of these points as we go through the presentation, but really it centralizes as an absorptive and secretory organ system. So it's critical for feed digestion, digestive passage throughout the gastrointestinal tract. The gastrointestinal tract is regulating luminal pH, so that'll become really important as we start talking about ruminal acidosis. It facilitates the nutrient absorption and then also compound excretion, in this case, urea recycling. So a way that ruminants can conserve nitrogen for use in the rumen later. I'm going to talk about this a bit more. This has been a pretty big focus of our group, the barrier function, and so recognizing the gastrointestinal tract, it has the largest absorptive or the largest surface area exposed, and it's also colonized by microbes. And so there's a high importance for the gastrointestinal tract to be able to facilitate feed digestion and nutrient absorption, while at the same time preventing those microbes from crossing the gastrointestinal tract and inducing a systemic immune response. On top of that, the gut is communicating frequently or continuously with the microbiota that reside within its gastrointestinal tract. So it's sensing the nutrients and compounds that the microbes are releasing, and it's also signaling back and helping to regulate the microbial communities that are within the gastrointestinal tract. We don't often think about gut health from a cow-calf perspective, but I think we can start thinking more broadly than we have historically. And this is some work that Justin Delver has done in our group, funded by the Saskatchewan Ministry of Agriculture through the ADF program, as well as SCA. And in this, we worked with researchers at Western Beef Development Center and subsequently LFCE to classify cattle based on their ability to maintain back fat thickness during winter, to calve early in the calving season, and to wean a heavy calf as a proportion of that cow weight. So the green bars represent the response for our high efficiency cows, and all of these values were statistically different between our low efficiency and high efficiency. So those high efficiency cows were able to maintain rump fat under an extensive winter condition. They calved earlier in the calving season, and they weaned calves that were heavier at weaning. How this ties back to gut health, or at least rumen function, is we evaluated what made those cows more efficient than those low efficiency cows. And we noted a couple important things. One is they actually had a smaller solid pool within the rumen. They actually had less dry matter that they carried within the rumen content, and they carried less NDF within those rumen contents than those low efficiency cows. As a response, they were able to pass more of that fiber out of the rumen faster and did that without decreasing the digestibility of that fiber. So these cows have some ability, and we don't know the full mechanisms yet, to be able to fill the rumen, but fill it to a lesser extent digest the available nutrients and pass out those less available nutrients, helping them to perform better as cows under our cow-calf, extensive cow-calf production systems. A lot of our work has focused on ruminal acidosis as a factor that affects gut health. And from a very simplistic standpoint, rumen acidosis is nothing but a balance between acid production in the rumen and acid removal. And that acid production is really critical because as the microbes are fermenting the feed in the rumen, they're producing energy substrates as those acids that are then utilized by cattle. So it's really the balancing act where whether cattle can remove enough acid to keep up pace with microbial acid production in order to regulate rumen pH. Related to this, we've been doing a fair bit of work on cereal grain processing, and cereal grain processing affects the amount of acid that will be produced in the rumen and the rate at which that acid is produced. What's really important, if we look at cereal processing as a value-added opportunity for the Saskatchewan economy, we can make sure that we adequately process that cereal grain. And if we don't, we have a lost opportunity that can be measured as fecal starch. Okay, and so this is a survey of some fecal samples coming out of large feedlots, most of them being in Alberta. And we were looking at the frequency of high fecal starch concentrations. And what I want to emphasize is generally we have quite a bit of species that's actually, or quite a bit of starch that's actually excreted in feces. So this represents a lost economic opportunity for our cattle producers here in Saskatchewan and in Alberta. If we take that down and we start looking at the cost of cereal grains, now these would be more average costs. Obviously, $400 a ton is pretty reflective of where we would be around today. But if we start looking at how fecal starch concentration is impacting financial costs, at least at the high levels of 9 and 12%, which we saw with too high a frequency, those cattle are excreting 8 or 11 cents worth of starch per animal per day in the feces. So a huge economic opportunity that might be lost. With that, we've done some work trying to improve the consistency of barley grain processing. In this case, we started evaluating flaking capability, and we weren't expecting producers to run out and install flakers, but recognizing long-term with development of low heat unit corn varieties, and more recently, the importation of corn from the US, that flakers might be more economical. And so we wanted to understand whether or not barley grain should be flaked similarly to corn, and what our data suggests is no, it shouldn't. And when we use recommended practices that we tested in a series of studies, we actually showed that from a feed conversion standpoint, we got about an 8.5% improvement over dry rolled barley or temper rolled barley. That was accompanied by no change in carcass weight, so no major change in retail value, at least when processed through our core standard. So that would be 450 grams per liter. But when processed too severely, we actually start seeing that reduction. A really good indication that we probably have rumen acidosis going on and corresponds to some metabolism work that we have suggesting we did have substantial reductions in ruminal pH and exposure to rumen acidosis. So we've been able to come forward with a series of recommendations on best management practices associated with barley grain flaking. If we look at this, what this meant from a fecal starch perspective, tying back to economics, we were able to take fecal starches from about 15% for our dry rolled barley, about 18% for our temper rolled barley, all the way down to 2% for our flaked grains. Really showing that if we adequately process those cereal grains, we can do a better job capturing that value and converting it into protein in the form of beef. So we continue to do quite a bit of work in this area, and we're hoping to be starting some new projects in the new year, really trying to get a better handle over how we can adequately assess cereal grain processing on farm. So there's a number of tools that are already available, certainly visual inspection, or we can use a processing index or percent fines. But the problem is these, even the more quantitative variables, are pretty subjective. They lack precision and they don't provide much opportunity for producers to impose altered decision-making ability. We can go with laboratory-based approaches. They obviously have a slower time frame. These processes also require regrinding once they reach the lab. And so again, they challenge the ability to make decisions arising from those. NIR can be used. It's much faster, so we reduce the time requirement, but we don't know what should be predicted. And again, we have a reprocessing requirement. And then finally, we've developed some NIR calibrations for fecal starch, probably the best measure, but by the time we're measuring the response, we've already lost opportunity. So we're working on developing new laboratory assays that reduce the time requirement, don't require regrinding, and can help producers and their nutritionists make better decisions on the adequacy of cereal grain processing for those individuals' starch sources. So that was really focusing on trying to make sure we have adequate acid production in the rumen. And if we do too good of a job there, we can lead to ruminal acidosis simply because acid removal doesn't keep pace. We've done a fair bit of work looking at ruminal acidosis, and we've been able to demonstrate that rumen acidosis does actually compromise the ability to absorb nutrients and buffer the rumen. And so we've shown in the face of a rumen acidosis challenge, we see reductions in major acids, acetate, propionate, and butyrate absorption. And it takes about a week for those cattle to recover from that acidosis induction event. After that, what we see is that cattle probably divert how they're buffering the rumen. So they actually divert bicarbonate into the saliva and they increase saliva production. So they're employing a different strategy to try to buffer those rumen contents. Okay, what's really interesting is the opposite response is observed. So cattle decrease acid absorption at the same time, increasing saliva production, probably to mitigate risk for internal damage coming from rumen acidosis. We've also shown that rumen acidosis induces a local pro-inflammatory response. And these are some results from some cell culture work. What I really want to highlight is that as soon as we expose these animals to antigens that are present coming from rumen acidosis, we induce a pro-inflammatory response. And so the rumen of the cattle are responding negatively to those antigens and starting to induce a local and then secondary systemic inflammatory response. We often point our fingers to feedlot cattle, but working with Dr. Bart Lardner, we've shown that it's not restricted to feedlot cattle. So these were cattle that were managed on extensive winter grazing systems, either corn grazing, swath grazing, barley green feed, or fed the same barley green feed under a dry lot setting. We had ruminally cannulated cattle out there, so we were able to measure ruminal pH, so minimum pH, mean pH, and the amount of time that pH was below 5.8. And in that case, we classified that as being rumen acidosis. We see very clear day effects. So the green bar shows the first day of turnout to a new paddock. The blue bar shows the second day, and the gray bar shows the third day of turnout to that paddock. And you can see minimum pH increases with advancing days in that paddock for all grazing systems except the dry lot feeding system. And so this is highlighting that cattle are employing selective grazing activity, maybe altering their dry matter intake by day to affect that rumen pH. And even in extensive grazing systems, we see situations where cattle are exposed to ruminal acidosis. In this case, you can see that corn was not actually worse than barley swath grazing, but both rather give relatively high risk for transient exposure to low rumen pH. On the feedlot side, we've evaluated when cattle are most at risk for ruminal acidosis. So we impose them through a backgrounding program of 21 days, a 21-day diet adaptation where we increase the proportion of barley grain and decrease the proportion of barley silage. And finally, we had them on a finishing program for 102 days and during which we measured ruminal pH continuously. So you're going to see the data broken out in backgrounding in yellow, in diet adaptation in blue, and finally in finishing in green. And what I want to highlight is we see a greatest severity of ruminal acidosis. It's actually occurring during the middle part and the latter part of the finishing phase, and not actually during the diet transition phase as we would have anticipated. We think this is a response of improved dietary management during our gradual dietary transition and a bunch of factors that lead to variable dry matter intake while they're consuming a high starch diet during that finishing phase. We've also shown that ruminal acidosis affects more than ruminal pH. So this is a rumen acidosis induction study. And you can clearly see that in the rumen, we did induce rumen acidosis. We were able to drop pH from over 6 down to about 5.3, 5.4. But not only did it drop ruminal pH, it also dropped pH in the large intestine. So another fermentative region suggesting that there might be more to ruminal acidosis than just low rumen pH. And this has really started our investigation into more distal regions of the gastrointestinal tract. And this is important because when we start looking at ruminal acidosis from a susceptibility standpoint, but also diagnostic tools, we're not able to take a look at what's happening in the rumen, and we're looking at the feces as an indicator of the total gut health. So diarrhea is commonly used as an indicator of ruminal acidosis, and certainly we see that with induction studies. Ruminal acidosis should be considered a production-limiting disease, and we've been able to identify some of the factors that relate back to those production outcomes. So post hoc at slaughter, when we look at what was different between those cattle that had ruminal acidosis and those that didn't, and we can classify them based on pathology scores. So those cattle that had rumen lesions, those cattle that had lung lesions, and those cattle that had liver abscesses, we see on average over the whole finishing period, they spent more time with severe rumen acidosis, and they had increased concentrations of acute phase proteins, indicative of a systemic inflammatory response, in this case, serum amyloid A and haptoglobin. So while these concentrations seem relatively low for inflamed cattle, recognize this is repeated sampling over time, and statistically, we see cattle that have greater indications of systemic inflammation having pathology scores, whereas those without pathology scores have less systemic inflammation and less severity for low ruminal pH. So this gets us back to the gut being a central organ, and we've been focusing on the absorptive and secretory side. What I want to shift now is to focus on barrier function, recognizing that that gut is the first arm of the immune response, and it's really there to promote absorption while preventing pathogen and antigen translocation as well as interaction. So this gets us down to barrier function of the gut, and we need to recognize that the gut is really composed of cells lining in parallel and anchoring those cells to one another to prevent open spaces between cells are a series of junctional proteins. They might be tight cell junctions, they could be desmosomes, they could be adherent junctions, and they could be gap junctions. And all of these work to help facilitate that reduced permeability or improved gastrointestinal barrier function. In feedlot cattle, we can see quite severe responses. So this is the inside of an animal that was purposely abruptly transitioned to a high grain diet. We can see sloughing of the rumen epithelia here, and we can see active lesions within the rumen. So once we get to this standpoint, we are no longer concerned about our tight cell junctions, because we have direct access to portal circulation. And we think that this effect is our causative outcome for induction of liver abscess. Okay, and so you can see liver abscesses located here on the liver of this animal. We've been looking at factors that influence risk for rumen acidosis and influence risk for altered gut barrier function. Our first work started looking at low feed intake, and low feed intake is is a really centralized component that many disease states go through. So all animals that go through a disease state, inflammation responses, one of the most highly conserved outcomes is a reduction in dry matter intake. So those cattle voluntarily and naturally go through periods of low feed intake. Animals that are exposed to heat stress voluntarily decrease their dry matter intake as one of the ways to cope with that environmental challenge. Animals that are going through transportation don't have access to feed and may not understand how to eat feed once they arrive at their new location. And so low feed intake occurs in a number of industry situations. This is one of the first studies we conducted on this area, and we purposely imposed low feed intake challenges, and we imposed it at 75, 50, or 25% of voluntary intake, and we held them at that level of dry matter intake for 5 days. Not surprising, when they don't eat or don't have access to feed, the amount of acid in the rumen decreases, so the short-chain fatty acid concentration goes down, and that means nutrients available for the animal are also depressed. That's not surprising. Ruminal pH goes in the opposite direction, and so those animals exposed to low feed intake, actually the greater severity has higher ruminal pH. And this brings about another challenge. We're often looking at ways to use remote sensor technology to indicate the health status of cattle. Rumen pH is one of those areas that people look for. And I would exercise a point of caution, because if we simply use low or use rumen pH without other information, we may make very erroneous conclusions. So for example, we might say this animal has the best managed rumen fermentation system because she has the highest pH. However, she has the highest pH simply because she's not eating. Okay, and so I don't think we want to use some of these sensor technologies without other information that is essential for the data interpretation. Not surprisingly, when they go through a period of feed restriction or low feed intake, we don't really see any pH depression, so no indication of rumen acidosis. However, we see some negative effects that come after this. And so when we look at short-chain fatty acid absorption across the rumen and recognize short-chain fatty acid absorption is critical for that nutrient delivery to the animal and also critical for regulation of rumen pH, we see that it is at least numerically, in this case, it's a tendency depressed, but we have several other studies that show this response is statistically different. So I'm going to be a little liberal and say we have a reduction in short-chain fatty acid absorption, and we see that that response is dose dependent. So let's think of our beef cattle that might be experiencing a transportation event. They could differ in terms of the duration of transport. They could differ in terms of the stress associated with that transportation event. And the severity of that stress event is likely to affect feed intake, and greater severities are likely to decrease nutrient transport to a greater extent. To evaluate barrier function, at least when we started this work, there were no published studies that we could use to develop methodology or really to apply methodology to evaluate how much would cross the gastrointestinal tract. So one of my students worked to develop a method to characterize permeability of the gastrointestinal tract, and we use a pulse dose of chromium EDTA, so we can orally dose the animal, or we can dose it into the rumen. And what we were able to show is chromium EDTA is excreted 99% of it within the first 48 hours. And when we measure that chromium EDTA, it's either coming out in the feces, the vast majority comes out in the feces, and about 3 to 5% comes out in the urine. So if that chromium EDTA comes out of the urine, it means it's crossed the gastrointestinal tract and it should not be transported, and it's excreted through the kidney into the urine. So us, as well as many other groups, have started to use chromium EDTA as an indicator of paracellular permeability. In that same study, when we exposed animals to low feed intake, we see severely restricted animals have increased chromium excretion. So that tells us permeability was compromised. So now we're increasing the potential for antigens or pathogens to cross the gastrointestinal tract. Most people stop at the challenges and they want to understand the impact of a challenge, but our group has been focused on trying to accelerate and understand the factors that drive recovery of cattle after those challenges. So feedlot cattle arrive at the feedlot and we don't want to just stop at studying the stress they experience on their way to the feedlot. We want to study how we can actually make a better or take better approaches to accelerate their recovery response. What we showed in this study was that the severity of that low feed intake event actually impacts their recovery response. So those animals that were restricted to a greater extent actually consumed the lowest strength feed restriction that was experimental imposed, but they still had the lowest feed intake during recovery week one and took the longest, had the slowest slope response to return to baseline dry matter intake. So those animals that are more sensitive, that go through a greater stress event, that drop feed intake longer, probably need more nutrients, and it takes them longer without any of those other stressors to return to dry matter or adequate dry matter intake. Now I want you to remember those animals also had the lowest dry matter intake during the first week of recovery. And what is rarely reported is low dry matter intake with low pH. But these animals not only had low dry matter intake, they also had rumen acidosis. So we clearly see a response where a low feed intake, at least for 5 days, is negatively affecting function of that gastrointestinal tract, particularly the rumen, increasing the risk for ruminal acidosis. And in fact, all of the animals that we used in this study that an imposed feed restriction had rumen acidosis as they started to return to ad libitum feed intake. So it really gives us some ideas on when we might need to start intervening or developing strategies to reduce risk for ruminal acidosis. And these are the data that I'm talking about. So when we look at the first week of recovery, recognize it's not a binge eating event because we see low feed intake during that first week, but we still see very high levels of or very high severity of rumen acidosis during that first week with a forage-based diet. So low feed intake really does increase risk for ruminal acidosis. And again, we have this treatment by time interaction showing that those animals that were feed restricted actually seem to overcompensate their recovery in terms of barrier function, but it takes longer for them to actually recover back to baseline levels. So it's a long-term effect that we're having on the gastrointestinal tract function of cattle, and we are increasing permeability of the gastrointestinal tract. That's seen better here where those animals in this case still have higher chromium output when we compare it at the treatment level, at least relative to the 50% restriction. Okay, and it's important to recognize this is 3 weeks after that low feed intake period. We've looked at other scenarios. This is a dairy model with abrupt weaning. So these calves were weaned on day 42 after 7 days of a step-down program to try to wean them off milk. Again, we used our chromium EDTA as an indicator of barrier function. We saw some interesting results that have been subsequently repeated in the literature where we see an age-dependent tightening of the gut. So that tells us that there is an increase in barrier function as these calves age. However, when we impose an abrupt weaning response, we completely disrupt that barrier function and we increase permeability of the gastrointestinal tract. That likely puts these calves at greater risk for other diseases and disorders as it probably induces a systemic immune response. So the data we've collected today or to date has been put forward in an invited review where we tried to characterize how the gut is responding in the face of a low feed intake challenge. We see dry matter intake shown on the figure here where we have adequate dry matter intake. Regardless of the reason why, we see dry matter intake drop during our low feed intake period and we see a gradual recovery. So it's not a very acute recovery response even for feed intake. When we look at absorptive capacity, we see absorptive capacity lag behind dry matter intake. And I've argued throughout this presentation, is this what's driving increased risk for ruminal acidosis after that period of low feed intake while they start to build dry matter intake. And when we look at barrier function, we see an initial reduction, increasing permeability of the gastrointestinal tract, followed by an overcompensation, probably to make sure that those animals survive and continue on. So this model is being tested both within our groups and other groups, and there's actually general support for the timeline of response that we're observing. So we've characterized that barrier function response and absorptive function response, but we want to also look for solutions to help those cattle recover. And one of the early studies, we looked at how diet upon receiving would impact the response. So we fed them a high forage diet or a moderate forage diet after feed restriction. We showed that feeding that high forage diet basically allowed those cattle to resume dry matter intake almost upon or immediately, whereas those moderate forage cattle took a substantial amount of more time to resume dry matter intake. And when we look at risk for ruminal acidosis, we really see a similar response, probably helping to drive some of the dry matter intake responses. But those cattle fed a high forage diet really didn't have ruminal acidosis, whereas those that were fed a moderate forage diet, and this was only 40% concentrate, had substantial ruminal acidosis after that low feed intake period. We've looked at other compounds. So this is a combination study of just simply decreasing the forage to concentrate ratio. In this case, it's on a feedlot-based diet. And in this diet, we actually added some additional functional ingredients, butyrate being one of those. And we showed that we were able to actually increase the absorption or tended to increase the absorption of acetate across the rumen and statistically increased butyrate absorption. So both of these should help contribute to regulation of rumen pH and deliver more energy to the animal to help improve performance outcomes. Recent work that's under review by Dan Watanabe has looked at abomasal butyrate supply. And so in this case, we are actually putting butyrate into the more distal part of the gastrointestinal tract, so past the rumen. And we showed that providing that abomasal butyrate increased total short chain fatty acid absorption, acetate, propionate, and butyrate absorption. So it looks like there might be some dietary tools that we can use to help improve the recovery or at least functionality of the gastrointestinal tract. So we've been talking loosely about barrier function, and what I want to highlight is cattle have very different structural components of their gastrointestinal tract as you move across regions. So the foregut, where the rumen fermentation activity occurs, we have a very complex epithelial lining, or basically the lining of the wall in the gastrointestinal tract. And so we actually see four individual strata, and many of those strata have multiple layers. And so this complex structure, which is much more like our skin, provides protection against kind of fibrous material that would occur in the rumen. And it also increases the number of barriers that microbes or antigens need to pass through before it can get into systemic circulation. If we compare that to the intestine, it's a much more simplified structure with a single cell layer. However, those cells employ different defense mechanisms. They can secrete mucus, and they can also secrete antimicrobial peptides to help prevent that microbial invasion. We've characterized the concentration of one antigen. In this case, it's lipopolysaccharide, or LPS. And for the first time, we were able to show that not only is the rumen high, but we actually see pretty high concentrations of LPS in different parts of the intestinal tract. And so this is really important because ileum is where most of the intestinal immune cells reside. It's an important reservoir. And this region is really poised for a pro-inflammatory response. We also characterize the barrier function of the gastrointestinal tract in healthy calves. And we showed surprisingly that the rumen and the omasum are actually quite tight tissues. So there's not much potential for organisms to cross. but we actually see higher permeability occurring in the small intestinal regions. So if we combine the intestinal permeability and high concentrations of antigens, we started to shift our thinking and started to say, well, maybe issues related to gastrointestinal tract health and permeability aren't restricted to the rumen, but might actually be caused or at least partially influenced by more distal regions. This led us to another problem where our original permeability marker only allowed for measurement of total tract permeability. So we couldn't say where in the gastrointestinal tract the markers were crossing. So we used or developed a new approach, and this approach allows us, at least in cannulated cattle, to separate ruminal and post-ruminal regions in terms of their permeability. So we infused cobalt EDTA post-ruminally into the abomasum, and we infused chromium EDTA into the rumen. And so the chromium EDTA still tells us our total barrier function, whereas cobalt EDTA tells us post-ruminal permeability. From this, we have the first data that is, at least to our knowledge, showing that the intestinal regions actually contribute substantially to total permeability. And that makes sense if we think about the structural regions. And in fact, the intestinal permeability accounted for about 67% of the total permeability. So again, pointing to these intestinal regions as a really critical area and highlighting that if we're looking for new solutions, ruminal drive solutions might not be the way to go. We also noted in this study that when we provided buffer, and this was a relatively insoluble buffer source of calcium magnesium carbonate, that we actually increased the barrier function of the post-ruminal regions. So not only do we care about ruminal buffering, but we might also want to start focusing on post-ruminal buffering mechanisms. Okay, altering this risk for inflammation can have key impacts on performance responses. There's some nice work out of Iowa State showing that activation of the immune system utilizes about a kilo of glucose per 12 hours. And obviously, if that glucose is going to support the immune system, that means there's less energy available for productive functions, whether that be growth of cattle or milk production for dairy cattle. And stimulation of that systemic immune response also increases amino acid uptake. Again, really important if we're talking about growth and lactation. This has really led us into the future of where our program is going. And what we're trying to do is test the model that I'm showing here, where while low feed intake is a centralized component, we're trying to understand whether disease, in this case, bovine respiratory disease or mastitis, might be driving increased risk for altered gastrointestinal permeability and consequently increased risk for liver abscesses. And so stay tuned for that work. Our hypothesis is that if we induce BRD, those cattle will drop feed intake, and that's been well established in the literature. Typically, they reduce feed intake by about 80% for 7 to 10 days. So a very severe feed restriction event. As they induce transiently low feed intake, they decrease the absorptive function, or we speculate they decrease absorptive function of the rumen in the intestine. It increases risk for rumen acidosis as they start to recover, and as a consequence, increase further risk for local and systemic inflammation and our sequential outcomes. This is supported in the literature. So if we look at disease states, we typically see that disease states actually drop feed intake. It increases systemic inflammation markers. It increases body mobilization. And in this case, we're just looking at another systemic inflammation marker. So there is good evidence to support the hypothesis that we put forth. And in pigs, at least, if they induce Mannheimia hemolytica, or sorry, in cattle, they induce Mannheimia hemolytica as a bovine respiratory disease challenge. We see altered oxygen consumption by the gastrointestinal tract. And in pigs, the response is to increase intestinal permeability. So we think we're probably following the right track And if we can prove this outcome, then we can start developing strategies to accelerate or enhance gut health for those cattle that are at greater risk of disease. So this is really going to be the primary focus of our group over the next 5 to 10 years. On top of that, water quality has been a major issue in Saskatchewan, and we know we have an abundant supply of water, but that water is really high in sulfates. And we see that sulfate entering the rumen being converted into hydrogen sulfide gas. Those sulfides and hydrogen sulfide can act with trace minerals, forming thiomolybdates, either in the rumen or distal parts of the gastrointestinal tract or in the blood. And that impacts or depletes trace mineral status of cattle. We also know that high levels of hydrogen sulfide production get exposed to the lungs, and then from the lungs, that hydrogen sulfide impacts energy metabolism in the brain, increasing risk for polio and acute death. And so obviously managing this water quality is a critical component for beef production in Saskatchewan, and we have some interesting advancements in this area that are coming in. With that, I'd like to thank you for your time, for your attention. I'd also, first of all, like to thank my team. I get to give talks, I get to travel and share the work we do, but really it is the students that do all the work and the students that push us to learn more and interpret the findings. So thank you to all the funders for supporting the work and supporting the funding that in the end trains these students that hopefully make a positive impact on the livestock industries in Western Canada.
That's great. Good job managing the clock. Lots of time for questions. So, any questions for Greg?
I have to repeat the question after.
Greg, we have feedlot cattle that we get ahead of them, they suddenly drop feed intake. Often they never really recover.
The question was, when we have feedlot cattle that we have a cyclic intake pattern, kind of that classical roller coaster, those cattle tend not, or they seem not to recover in terms of a performance response. So how do we actually address that and stimulate their recovery and performance outcomes? So the first part of that question is, why don't they recover? And it's really difficult to know whether it's truly ruminal acidosis or some other factor, but we do know a couple things. One is ruminal acidosis is a self-fulfilling prophecy. So cattle that are exposed to rumen acidosis are more susceptible to having another bout of rumen acidosis, even when they consume less grain. Okay, and that work has been shown or conducted out at Lethbridge Research Station by Karen Bushman's group. And it's pretty clear that repetitive rumen acidosis episodes have an increasing severity of response as episodes advance. So we think that is probably one of the outcomes. We don't see evidence that a highly, I'm gonna use kind of industry jargon, burnt out rumen. So I showed a picture of a rumen that had burnt off papillae. Those don't recover. And so effectively those cattle that have been exposed to severe episodes of rumen acidosis have compromised absorptive surface area, and they will for the rest of their life. So there's really nothing we can do in terms of helping those cattle redevelop those papillae. It's essentially the same as if we would burn your skin. Okay? The skin will recover, it'll form a barrier, but it's going to have altered morphology. Okay. So the question then is, what do we do to prevent it? Well, feeding management is a really critical part, and bunk scoring has helped advance that area a lot, making sure that we're providing enough feed, but looking at both the feed in the bunks as well as cattle behavior to determine how much their next allocation should be. Adequate cereal grain processing, touched on cereal grain processing. Over processing obviously increases that risk. Under processing results in lost opportunity. We've been doing a lot of work in characterizing fiber adequacy for feedlot cattle, and we have good work showing that physically effective NDF matters and helps those cattle regulate ruminal pH. And UNDF may be important, not because we want to increase UNDF too much, because it decreases performance outcomes, but there probably is a minimum UNDF that cattle require to maintain ruminal function. So I think it goes back to really good management practices from feed delivery and feeding management. It's not formulation. We can formulate a good diet, but we need people that can actually manage the cattle appropriately to make sure the diet is being delivered adequately.
So what do you think happens when, let's say, you know, we get a storm and those cattle go off feed and they're not getting back on. In that case, how severe do you think that renal acidosis is? Obviously, we can't look inside the feed if they have
problems. Yep.
Where do you start to draw the line on this is a group that not do well?
Yep. So in challenge situations, whether it be weather or could be disease outbreak events where cattle go off feed, I would argue none of those cattle have ruminacidosis, or very few have ruminacidosis while they're off feed. And that's really where our work has been looking at is, okay, if you can't predict the off feed event, but you can detect it, what can we start doing to help those cattle accelerate recovery back on feed while minimizing risk for factors that impact gut health? And so there are feed additives that are potentially available. I think they still require more development. I showed work that Dan did with butyrate, showing that it enhances absorptive capacity. And there might be opportunity for post-ruminal delivery of butyrate in specialized situations. There could be opportunities, and quite often in storm situations, producers will decrease the amount of concentrate in the diet, increase the amount of forage. And we have data suggesting that that does actually improve the recovery response. So there are practical ways to come back and try to help those cattle recover. And that I think you'll see coming out of our program over the next 5-10 years, hopefully more tools to help those cattle. Dave? Yeah. So the question was, did any of our treatments increase the risk for bloat? And so you're talking about our low feed intake treatments or? Mm-hmm. Yeah, so really in terms of bloat, the only treatments we saw really stimulate greater risk was overprocessing of cereal grains. And that isn't really surprising. So on the overflaked barley, we did increase bloat occurrence, but these are small numbers with small parts. So we don't talk a lot about it in the data simply because it's too small of a population. But we can look back at those health records and see higher frequency of bloat treatment under those conditions. In terms of our low feed intake responses and recovery responses, these are all cannulated animals. And so I would argue already risk for bloat is low because gases can escape through the cannula, and we're dealing with relatively small sample sizes. So we didn't actually have any reported episodes of bloat in any of those studies. Tim.
What's happening? Why is
So the question was, why do we see a reduction in short-chain fatty acid absorption and a reduction that is so acute? I didn't have time to show the data, but we see very rapid reductions in absorptive surface area. And in fact, in the rumen, we can see reductions of over 50% in 3 to 5 days. So the scary part is it looks like the gut responds very rapidly with retrogressive adaptation, and it takes a prolonged time for proliferative adaptation. And the data available suggests 6 to 8 weeks to maximize absorbed to surface area. And our data suggests you can lose it in 3 to 5 days under unideal situations. What I think it is a conserved biological adaptation. So ruminants in the wild go through periods of high nutrient and feed availability and periods of low nutrient and energetic availability. The gut is a really large consumer of energy, right? 20 to 30% of the oxygen consumption is consumed by the gut. And so it's an expensive tissue to maintain. And so if ruminants are going through a period of low nutrient availability, it's energetically advantageous to reduce the weight of the gastrointestinal tract to decrease maintenance energy requirements. I think it's under our more intensive management where we reverse that very fast, as because feed's always available and high quality feed, that we start seeing negative consequences where basically our management is not following the biology. But that's a speculation.
Oh, one just came from Marianne. Marianne's wondering, what do you think of using some of this research to capture carbon credits? What would need to happen for producers to benefit from increased feed efficiency and more?
So I think that's a, so Marianne questioned, I guess maybe they could read it. Can we capture some of the feed efficiency or lower emissions? I think it really depends on how emissions are going to be reported. If we are going to be allowed to use emission intensities, then I think we have an opportunity to capture these benefits. If we're looking at total emissions, it might be difficult. Because quite often, if we have more feed digested, we end up producing more gases as a consequence of that feed digestion. But we'll do it more efficiently, right? We'll produce more beef per unit of feed, and so our intensity drops. So for barley grain processing, as an example, there's a huge opportunity in terms of just reducing fecal starch to reduce our greenhouse gas intensities. But we have to be very clear what our targets or our production outcomes are going to be, because if we're looking at total gas production rather than intensities, the outcome might be different. Okay. So the question was whether dairy cattle also drop short-chain fatty acid absorption around calving because they drop dry matter intake. The data that's available, and this is really old data, but good studies going back to 1985 show they do reduce absorption in association with a lower energy diet, which we typically would feed during the dry period. So it's not looking at the effect of low feed intake, but it's looking at the consequence of feeding a low energy diet during the dry period, showing that they have the lowest rates of dry matter intake on those diets, which would happen at calving, and that it takes about 6 to 8 weeks for them to maximize absorption rate. So that's really where our proliferative adaptation data came from. It's fully supportive of a high prevalence of ruminal acidosis for dairy cows in early lactation. And I think there's a lot of opportunity to kind of help those cows manage that increase in dry matter intake and increased fermentability at the same time. Off the hook.
I think we've waited the requisite 6 seconds of silence. So thank you very much for a great stimulating conversation, great responses to questions. Thank you for all that. And thanks to everyone for coming. So please join me in congratulating Greg on a good presentation. So for everyone here and everybody online, reminder that our next seminar in the city is going to happen on Wednesday afternoon. Well, this is the end. Enjoy the rest of your day.